afternoon, I'll just teach us a few carefully. Before we begin, everyone, please take a moment to come up and install those in my cooperation. In your missal today, there are two sets of readings. We are actually going to be using the second set of readings, which starts on page 93. So, we'll be following along those that are reading there. Our opening song is number 445.
Thank you. practicing the virtues of family life and in the bonds of charity, and so in the joy of your house, delight one day in eternal rewards. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. parents of Jesus took him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord, just as it is written in the law of the Lord, every male that opens the womb shall be consecrated to the Lord, and to offer the sacrifice of a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons, in accordance with the dictate in the law of the Lord. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. This man was righteous and devout, awaiting the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he should not see death before he had seen the Christ of the Lord. He came in the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to perform the custom of the law in regard to him, he took him into his arms and blessed God, saying, "Now, Master, you may let your servant go in peace, according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you prepared in the sight of all the peoples, a light for revelation to the Gentiles, and glory for your people, Israel." The child's father and mother were amazed at what was said about him, and Simeon blessed them and said to Mary his mother, "Behold, this child is destined for the fall and rise of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be contradicted. And you yourself a sword will pierce, so that the thoughts of many hearts may be revealed." There was also a prophetess, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel of the tribe of Asher. She was advanced in years, having lived 7 years with her husband after her marriage, and then as a widow until she was 84. She never left the temple, but worshipped night and day with fasting and prayer. And coming forward at that very time, she gave thanks to God and spoke about the child to all who were awaiting the redemption of Jerusalem. When they had fulfilled all the prescriptions of the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. The child grew and became strong, filled with wisdom, and the favor of God was upon him. The Gospel of the Lord. We have some idea in our culture of what makes families well adjusted, psychologically balanced, healthy, and happy. We might speak of good communication, mutual respect, the right balance of authority and obedience, parents that know how to let go of their children appropriately. But none of this has to do directly with holiness. And our feast day today is the Feast of the Holy Family. It's meant to draw attention to this more elusive quality. What precisely is it that makes a family holy? Is it something like the other qualities I propose, or something beyond them? So let's examine Jesus, Mary, and Joseph to see if we can see why they are called the Holy Family. First, there's Joseph. He stands in a long line of biblical dreamers. Notice that when God wants to get Joseph's attention, he sends him a dream, and then Joseph does whatever that dream tells him to do. Now, his Old Testament namesake, Joseph, from the book of Genesis, was also an interpreter of dreams. Remember that he interpreted the dreams of Pharaoh, and that brought him into favor with Pharaoh. Remember also Daniel. During the time of the Babylonian captivity, he also attended very intelligently to dreams and told the king what his dreams meant. You'll remember that Jacob had a famous dream of angels ascending and descending on a great ladder. Abraham, Jacob's grandfather, falls into a deep slumber and experiences a startling vision of God. People across cultures have long been impressed by the strange power of dreams, how they can haunt us and communicate meaning to us, even though they seem rather bizarre or illogical on the surface. But the biblical authors saw dreams as a privileged means of divine communication. And so, for instance, the psalmist says, he praised God who even at night directs my heart. Well, the point here is that Joseph did not follow his own projects, his own plans, but the project and plan of God revealed to him from above, in his case, usually in a dream. Like anyone else, Joseph must have had his own hopes, his own expectations for life, but he was willing to set these aside in favor of what God was asking him to do, even when that would cost him. And we see that clearly in the stories that we've been hearing during the Advent and now Christmas seasons. And sometimes what Joseph is commanded to do is kind of dicey, dangerous business. You know, taking a pregnant woman in for his wife when that could have got her and him in trouble, moving to faraway places like Egypt to avoid King Herod and so forth. Well, we hear the story a few months later. A voice from on high sent him in a dream, directing Joseph to take the child and his mother to flee to Egypt. And then some years later, that same voice directs him to take the family to Nazareth, now that King Herod is dead. And Joseph obeys. Now, would you point to Joseph as a well, psychologically balanced model for males? It seems likely, but the Bible directs our attention to his holiness, which somehow seems linked with his willingness to follow a higher will. And then there's Mary. Again, like any young woman of that time and place, she probably had hopes and expectations, whom she would marry, how many children God would give her, how she would contribute to her community. But then she receives an even more startling indication of God's will through an angel who lays out for her an extraordinary plan. Though a virgin, she would give birth to a son who would be the Son of God. Now, we've heard this scene so many times that we probably take it for granted. But can you put yourself in the shoes of Mary, who may have been as young as 14 years old when she heard this message from an angel? And Mary, I mean, it's like Mary's life interrupted. Out of the blue comes this overwhelming invitation. And how much of it did she really understand? Did she foresee the ramifications it would have in her life? And we can see this from her questioning. How could it happen without having relations with a man? And what would this mean for her life? And yet, she recognizes this as the desire of God. And so, she reorders her entire life. May it be done to me according to your word. She gave herself over to the will of God. Like Joseph, she surrenders to. One thing this says to us is that for holy people, their lives are not about them. And not just intellectually, they did viscerally in their bodies. They changed their lives physically according to the wishes of God. Now consider Jesus in Luke's gospel for today. This is the one glimpse we have of Jesus as a child. The finding in the temple. Jesus among the doctors of his religion. And of course, Jesus obeyed his parents and loved them. That, after all, was a commandment. But then, just as he is beginning adolescence, he leaves his parents during the family visit to Jerusalem. He stays behind among the and scribes, asking and answering questions, caught up in the ecstasy of understanding the ways of God. My sense is, he just like lost track of time and a sense of awareness of where he was, because he was so enraptured with the deep theological discussion he was having with some of the smartest minds of his time. But then his parents, on the way home to Nazareth, notice, where's our son? And they go back, and they find him in all faces of the temple. And then Jesus utters that devastating line to his parents, "Why were you looking for me? Did you not know that I must be in my Father's house?" Jesus loved his parents, but his life was finally not about them or their desires. It was about the desire of his Father in heaven. He began from the earliest moments of his conscious life to listen to the Father, to follow his promptings, to do his will. This is the first account in the Gospels where we get a glimpse of Jesus directing his life not to his own plans, not even to the plans of his remarkably holy parents, but directing his life to do the will of God. So maybe this is what it means to be holy. It's to realize that your life is not about you. It means to place yourself radically in the hands of God, to be about God's business above all. So there's the challenge. We must make our families places where the will of God is discerned and heeded. Now, how do we know what needs to turn our life over to God? Well, here is a basic spiritual principle. Whatever prompts you in the course of your decisions to grace love, grace justice, grace truth and integrity, grace self-offering, that's probably the voice of God in you. Thomas Merton once said that if you are faced with two decisions, the one that is the hardest has the greatest chance of being God's will for you. So, are you willing to say, yes, that's how I want to structure my life around discerning and doing the will of God? Because if you can, you have found holiness. When all the members of the family follow that call together, they become a holy family. Let us stand up together and profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father of all men, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, dear God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Forgiven all things for me. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. For by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and he became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He is ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again. Jesus, as he matured, we pray now that the favor of the Lord may be upon us all, as may be upon us as we give voice to the needs of all around us.
For the church, that we treat our sisters and brothers with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience as we strive to build God's kingdom throughout the entire human family. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord,
for the leaders of nations, that they may respect the bond of individual families, as well as foster the unity of the human family across nations and cultures. Let us pray to the Lord. For parents of babies, children, and teens, that they may exercise patience as they raise their children with love and kindness, let us pray to the Lord. For healing and hope for parents who have lost a child, let us pray to the Lord. That members of this community may reach out to those without immediate family and offer their love and time to give witness to the bond we share in Christ, let us pray to the Lord. That we remember Cecilia and Holy Fry in our prayers and hope that they may lace Christmas celebration with their family, let us pray to the Lord. That we remember Dixie Messinger in our prayers as she recovers from her heart surgery, let us pray to the Lord. That the intentions on our basket are answered, let us pray to the Lord. For all the prayers that we hold in the silence of our hearts, for all our intentions spoken and unspoken. Let us pray to the Lord.
Heavenly Father, we look to the Holy Family for inspiration and support as we nurture the bonds of love that bind our families together. Listen to our needs and grant our prayers through the one who's come to proclaim, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for your goodness you have received the bread we offer you. Fruit of the earth and work of human hands, it will become for us the bread of life. Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received the wine we offer you. Fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become our spiritual bread. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice of yours sacrifice of conciliation, humbly asking that through the intercession of the Virgin Mother of God and Saint Joseph, you may establish our families firmly in your grace and your peace through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up your hearts, Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord and our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For on the feast of this awe-filled mystery, though invisible in his own divine nature, he has appeared visibly in ours. And begotten before all ages, he has begun to exist in time. So that raising up in himself all that was cast down, he might restore unity to all creation and call straying humanity back to the heavenly kingdom. And so with all the angels we praise you as in joyful celebration we acclaim. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Lord, we pray for every evil, O Lord, graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ.
Join us in our new song number 777, Love One Another.
Thank you.
my heart to our God is open. If that does us to God, we are in our actions against the wickedness and death of the devil.
I pray God we give you the power to pray, and do thou work this in the heavenly muscles. Grant thou power for us to set down. Save the Lord, we have the Holy Spirit. Warm on to the world, speaking to the ruined souls.
I hope everyone had a nice Christmas. And always, as always, could you help us sanitize the pew where you sat and the missile that we used by wiping them with a towel found in the box on the table in the back of the church? We thank you in advance for doing so. We cannot pass the collection plate, so there is a basket on the table in the back of the church for contributions. And we thank you for that as well. Also, much to leave today with some gifts. We have a book for you written by Matthew Kelly. And we also have a little package. I was supposed to give it out in Advent and forgot. But it also covers Christmas, so maybe you could make a little use of it. Also, the envelopes that you use for contributions, those are available in the back. Really help if you pick them up so that you don't have to spend money on postage for that. Mass for Mary, Mother of God, which is January 1st, of course, is tradition here at this parish to have Mass for that the night before the vigil. So that will be December 31st at 5:30 p.m. Let us pray. Bring those who refresh with this heavenly sacrament, the most merciful Father, to imitate constantly the example of the Holy Family, so that after the trials of this world, we may share their company forever through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go forward.
Please join us in our closing song number 444, Antiphonium in Tempo.
Thank you.